Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Skip E Lowe Looks at Hollywood. Tonight's guests include a Tony Award winner from the Broadway show Raisin, Miss Virginia Capers, along with that multiple talented gentleman entertainer, Mr. George Kirby. And tonight, a special treat, the lovable love child. And now, here he is, the man of the half hour, Skip E Lowe.
George Kirby, tell me, what caused the great change in George Kirby's life? You know, you've had a lot of trouble in your life. And tell me about it. What has caused the great change in your life?
Well, I've had misfortune. I've had hardships. But through it all, my faith in the Lord above, I've come out of it all right. Uh-huh. And I've been blessed to have a talent that will carry me through now.
That's right. Great talent.
Yes.
George, you seem a little happy today.
I'm looking at
you, and you seem very, very happy.
Both of us are happy.
Both.
Yeah, I'm a Gemini.
That's right, you are. Your birthday's coming up, right?
That's right.
Oh, well, congratulations. Happy birthday. I'm June 6th, and you're June 7th?
June 8th.
8th?
Yeah.
That's nice.
Dino is June 7th.
Dean Martin is. That's
right. Dean is going to be on June 7th. There's three of us right together there.
Uh-huh. What have you been doing, George? George Kirby, you know, you travel a lot. Like, you've been on ship cruises now. That's new type of show business, you know.
Well, most of your nightclubs are going to the water now.
Right.
And those ships. I played the Norway. I played the Fair Wind, the Fair Seas. Uh-huh. And the last 12 I've done has been on the Fair Sky, and I got about 12 more to do, which is just wonderful.
You're enjoying that, aren't you, George?
Yes, I am. I really am.
How about all your voices? You're still doing...
Oh, yeah.
Your great impressions. You know, you happen to be a great, great singer. Virginia Capers is sitting next to you.
Yes, she is.
And
bless her heart.
Yes, and she's a great singer.
Yes, she is. A great actress.
Yes, she won the Tony Award in Raisin. And how are you, Virginia?
Well and happy.
Like I was saying, George Kirby, great singer. I mean, not just an impressionist, not a great impressionist, but a great singer, as a nightclub singer.
A lot
of people don't know that. They see him on that.
This has been an ongoing admiration society for years and years and years.
Uh-huh.
My heart fills up when I watch him, and I'm thrilled and enthralled. I almost got to play his in-law, almost.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
What was that?
A Full House or something like
that?
Uh-huh. And they didn't hire us. They didn't know what they missed.
I see. But, George, looking back in your life right now, do you have any regrets?
None.
No?
None. Because everything that happened to me in the past was a lesson. Uh-huh. And a lesson well learned, and a lesson that I'll never forget.
Uh-huh.
You know, some people have lessons and they're things that are thrown at them, and as soon as they bypass or get past them some kind of way, they forget about it.
Uh-huh.
You know, I still have mementos around that I... As a matter of fact, I was just telling Virginia today when I was at the golf course this morning.
Yes.
And I got on the fair. I had a beautiful fairway shot, you know. Mm-hmm. And as I started riding down toward the wall, I thought back, a flashback.
Yes.
You know, a quick flashback, like some people say when they're drowning or something, that the life flashed before them.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a flashback to the 4 years I was incarcerated. And here I was out in the free world again, really appreciating things that I had overlooked before, you know. And I said my Lord's Prayer.
What have you looked over before, George? What have you really...
Being able to open a door whenever I wanted to open it.
Simple things.
Eat what I want to eat when I want to eat it. Uh-huh. Dress the way I want to dress, you know.
I understand that you and Mrs. Reagan are with the... you're doing the same thing she's doing.
Yes, yes.
Tell us about that.
Well, she's got a campaign going, fighting drugs, as everyone well knows.
Uh-huh.
And I've been doing it without a lot of publicity.
Right.
You know, I wasn't looking for publicity.
Did you know that, Virginia? He doesn't really look for publicity. He just doesn't.
He never has. This is one of the things. How George Kirby became a star, I will never know.
Mm-hmm.
Because he never sought publicity.
Yes.
He never sought acclaim. He just went on and did his job so clean and so fine that people had to talk about him.
Yes, yes.
You know, He is the most unpretentious star I know. True. And he's such a genuine talent.
They call him the gentleman of entertainers.
To be sure.
The gentleman of entertainers. That's what they call George Kirby.
All the ladies can attest to that. Uh-huh. Because I have yet to know a lady that George, even those ladies who were not ladies, mm-hmm. that George has not treated as a lady. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. He has always made us feel like we were important, that we're somebody, that we're special. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when you touch him, when you hug him,
yes.
it's because here is somebody you feel really cares about you.
Yes, yes.
I mean, you know, it's not a physical affair, it's uh-huh. that spiritual love affair. Yes.
George, you started where? Back in Chicago?
Yeah, that's
Tell us home. About those days in Chicago. You know, Club Delisa, right?
It was really jumping in those days, you know. They talk about the roaring 20s, you know. It was the roaring 30s and 40s, you know, for me. Uh-huh. And, I started my first job. I quit school mm-hmm. in order to help out at the house, right? And I got a job as a pearl diver in Rum Boogie. Uh-huh. Rum Boogie was a nightclub that was owned by Charlie Glenn, who was affiliated with Joe Louis, the world heavyweight champion at that time.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And as a pearl diver, I come in the evening, you know, and I'd start pearl diving. I see you looking at me when I say that. Yes. That's dishwashing.
Dishwashing. I was wondering what he means by pearl diving.
Yeah. I didn't
yeah.
know.
Yeah, those pearly
you
white dishes.
Dishwasher.
That's right.
I see.
And at the same time, I got a job as a bus boy.
Yes.
So I'd run out and bust the tables down, so the waiters would give me 50 cents for each table I'd bust down for them, you know.
Uh-huh.
And I was doing good, and I started watching the entertainers and the performers, you know.
Uh-huh.
And I would duplicate what they were doing, you know.
Ah.
So I said, hey, I like to get in this business,
uh-huh.
you know. So I asked them for a job, you know, and Charlie Glenn said, well, see Joe Ziggy Johnson, he's the director of the show, you
mm-hmm,
know.
Mm-hmm.
I go to Ziggy, I said, Ziggy, give me a chance in the show. He said, well, see Charlie Glenn, you know, he owns
uh-huh,
the club.
Uh-huh.
And they passed the buck back and forth.
Uh-huh.
Till one night, I waited till Saturday night, and I quit. And I went out in Washington Park, and I cried, you know, and everything, because they pushed me around. And I walked over to Club Delisa.
Uh-huh.
Which was right around the corner from my house.
Right.
And I walked in there and took the porter sign down and said, I'm going to be a porter. And I worked there from porter, worked up to bottle washer, to bartender. And those days, they didn't have no child labor law.
Uh-huh.
15 years old, I was bartender.
15.
And then one day, I jumped over the bar and I asked Sammy Dyer to give me a chance in the show. He said, what do you do? I said, I talk like other people, you know.
Uh-huh.
He said, well, give me an example. I said, well, like Amos now, you know. You know, Andy, there's a shortage of women going on today.
Uh-huh.
And Andy said, yeah, the one I had out last night only come up to my belt buckle.
Uh-huh.
And he said, you're a mimic.
Uh-huh.
So I waited till I got home and looked it up in the dictionary to see what he
that
called
word.
Me.
Yeah. Yeah. You didn't know what he called
before
you.
I go back and cut him.
Uh-huh.
And it went on from there, and they called me out. He said, first he said, get your routine together.
Uh-huh.
He says, and I'll try you out on the next show. Each show ran 4 weeks, a month.
Uh-huh.
So I got my stuff together, and one of the musicians in the Red Saunders Band
right.
did an arrangement for me. And I went on.
What was your first impressions? Who did you?
The first impression, the band was playing blum, dum, blum, dum, blum, dum, blum, dum, dum, blum. And I was walking around
the
stage saying, call for Philip Murray.
Yes. Uh-huh.
And that's how I opened up.
Ah, wonderful.
And I was doing Ned Sparks, and I was doing Wallace Berry and Marie Dressler.
Wallace Berry.
Yeah, Wallace Berry.
Wallace Berry. Tell me. Do Wallace Berry right now. Say.
Oh, gosh, you don't want to see me do Wallace Berry, do you?
Wallace Berry. Very, very few people do Wallace Berry nowadays. You know, they really
Most
do.
Most people don't know who
they
he
don't
is
know.
Anymore.
They don't.
I don't know. You see, you don't have no great character voices today like you had yesterday.
They don't, do they?
They don't. They, all
the actors,
in this method.
They all sound alike.
They all sound alike?
They all had individual sounds. The
old stars, you could tell. Lock a room up.
John Wayne.
Open up the transom.
Yes.
Not see them now.
Yes.
And just listen to the voices in there.
Right.
And you'd hear voices like, well, what are we going to do? Are we going to stay here all day? We should get to work right away. How about you?
Take it easy, my little friend. Mm. We'll find out where the Morty's fucking is. Right, my friend? You guys keep arguing back and forth, and sooner or later we're going to get that Maltese falcon. See, right away you knew it was Andrew's sisters.
Sydney Greenstreet and Peter Lorre. Oh, fantastic. Yeah. You have them down, boy. Oh, I tell you.
You remember Edna May Oliver?
Yes. Yes, of
course. She used to always play a queen or something.
Yes, yes.
As long as I'm queen of England, you do as I say, do.
But you know one's my favorite is Pearl Bailey, the one.
Oh, honey, now, everyone asked. I come off the stage and some of them just say, you didn't do Pearl, honey.
They always love that one, don't they?
They want Pearl.
They do.
Yes.
Yeah, she's a...
Pearl wants Pearl, too.
Virginia Capers, what is new and exciting in your life? I just heard that you got a series. Come on, tell us about that.
After 11 tries. Uh-huh. The 12th, it was a heartbreaker, Skippy. Uh-huh. The 12th one I did, they tell you, go and get the script. And, you know, with my background and my experience, what do I need to go get the script? You know,
right.
But this time I went and I got the script, but I waited until the day of the interview to go and get the script. And the role was so good, and they said, it's a pilot, it's blah, 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 and I'm excited now. You know, uh-huh. Pilot money, if it doesn't go to series, it means you make the money, right? Uh-huh. And then I got the role. The role is a magnificent role. Uh-huh. She is the head of the probation department. She has been working on a program to get it funded so that police officers would be probation officers.
Yes.
And she picks up this one guy whose portfolio impressed her.
Uh-huh.
Because he did things spontaneously and things that were for the good of all. But he was a schlock cop.
Yes, yes.
You know? Who's played by Michael Nuri, by the way.
Uh-huh.
And he comes into her office. He's not paying any attention. Her little subordinate is trying to give him the rules and regulations of the day. He picks up the phone. He's out for chasing criminals. Uh-huh. And I'm watching from a distance. Now, you get this lady. She walks in, she disconnects him, and he says, you cut me off. She said, that isn't all I'm going to cut off if you don't put down that phone. My type of broad.
Did you know, Virginia is in a new movie right now with Richard Pryor.
Jojo Dancer.
Yes.
The reviews are...
I like the movie.
Do you?
Yeah. I just didn't think he had to flash back as many times as he did.
Uh-huh.
To himself on the mm-hmm. on the operating table.
I haven't seen the movie, and I understand
because the movie is great.
It is good.
All the characters are wonderful.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And she's in the film. And
yes, she is.
I'm the fortune teller in the whorehouse.
How
and,
nice.
And if you need any help on probation, see me.
Fantastic.
Virginia, tell us about your. Lafayette Place.
Would you hand me that one?
I certainly will, darling.
We have just picked up a major endorser.
Uh-huh.
And I will be on CBS with her.
With
Angela Lansbury.
Yes. How wonderful.
And she sees where what I am trying to do is not only worthwhile, that it's overdue and should have been done a long time ago. I'm in the process of raising $5 million to create the first black theater complex in Hollywood. It will be a part of the Hollywood revitalization effort. Mm-hmm. And it will be some place that no matter where you are in the world, mm-hmm. and you say, I want to see black actors, I want to see black performers, because we're going to have a showroom too.
Uh-huh.
Good.
Yes, and we're going back to the old style in clothes.
I'm going to ask you both this question. I got to.
And so anyway, she has come to our fore, and we're really working hard on it. And everybody can get their name on the Wall of Fame by sending us a donation.
How nice.
Yes, to help us build
the Lafayette Players.
Lafayette Players, West.
In Los Angeles?
The address at this particular time, our office address is 601 South Kingsley Drive.
Okay. Tell me something. Black entertainers today, are you too satisfied what's happening with our black entertainers?
Why do you think I want a theater?
Yeah, I just want to know if you're satisfied.
I am not satisfied.
No way.
Why?
No way.
Tell me why. What should we do about it? What should be done?
You need more parts for them. In other words, the script comes up. It don't have to say black or white.
That's right. Exactly.
The same thing that happened to Lou Gossett. He took a script, and the script was written
for
a white fella.
That's right.
But he took it and read it.
Yes.
And we've got to stop waiting for them to write black parts. We got to go ahead. We have to write them ourselves. Mm-hmm.
I agree.
Why do you think it won at theater? I won a Tony in 1974.
It was in 1974?
It was 1974. Raisin. I'm the first black actress to win the Tony without having to share it with a white actress.
How wonderful. Congratulations.
How many doors opened for me?
Yes.
Not one. After I came off the road, after playing to standing room only for 3 years on Broadway, taking a show on the road playing to standing room only.
Yes.
I come off of the road, and for 9 months, I sit without a job. Without a job.
It don't make sense, you know.
You know, I beat out Carol Channing and Michelle Lee. Michelle Lee is all over the TV.
Tell me something. Are you both satisfied with our American government here in this country? The American government, do you think that has a lot to do with it?
Well, let's face it. Even though Mr. Reagan is...
Our system, the government system.
Even Mr. Reagan is an actor, and he is not for the arts the way the Kennedys were. Also, you have to realize the trends in the country are changing. We're not interested in culture like we used to be.
Yes.
We're now talking about the homeless and the hungry.
Yes.
You see, which of course is necessary. But when it's all over and the civilization passes,
yes,
the only thing that is left is the art.
I see. George, what do you feel about our government here in this country?
Well, number one, the government is involved now with playing chess with Russia. Mm-hmm. And they're so busy that the entertainment only comes by when Sinatra and them put on something in the White House, or they have some people at the White House. They think about show business at that particular moment, but that's all.
Yes.
You see, and the thing is, what they should be worried about is we've already been invaded. Mm-hmm. So forget about the bombs and the guns and the rockets and all that stuff, because we've already been invaded with drugs.
Yes, yes.
Mm.
Yes,
we're drugging the country. They're getting drugs in left and right.
Where do you think the drugs really coming from, George, mostly?
They're coming from any place where they can get the poppy seeds. Anywhere where they can grow the poppies, that's where it's coming from.
I see. George Kirby, War II. During you served in the World War II.
Yes.
Tell me about those days. You know, you're a gentleman, and, you know, you love your country. And you went and served for our World War II.
Yes. I served both theaters, too.
Yes, you did.
I was in Europe and in the South Pacific.
Yes.
And we had segregated armies in.
We did?
That's right.
I see.
You had all black outfits and you had all white outfits. And there were times that we had battles among ourselves.
I see.
You know?
You don't think that changed? There's not much change in that today.
Well, it's changed now quite a bit.
It has.
Number one, they're getting more money. I only got $21 a month.
Yes.
You know? They're integrated now,
yes,
you know,
yes.
You'll find black officers and things like mm-hmm. that. We only had a handful of black officers in those days.
Yes.
Now you find them coming out of West Point and everywhere, you know.
Sophie Tucker, let's think. Sophie Tucker brought you, tell me about Sophie Tucker.
Well, Sophie Tucker, I was playing the Paramount Theater with Duke Ellington. And got word from Sophie Tucker that she was going to Europe, to London, and she was taking me with her, if it was possible. We worked through William Morris' office then, you know, they signed up. And I went over in 48 with her. We played the London Casino Theater, and it was just wonderful. And each night, you know, I had to stop by her dressing room before leaving, you know. And she says, "How's Margaret?" Well, Margaret was my aunt, my mother's sister. And she was known as the modern Black Patty in her day.
Uh-huh.
And when she was starring, Sophie was on the bill.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
And Sophie remembered her from all this time,
yes.
You know. And she sent her a book, you know, and everything. Uh-huh. And every night, Jack LaRue would come by and pick her up.
Jack LaRue.
Yeah. And it was wonderful. You know, we had a good time together.
Great lady.
Yes, she was.
Great lady.
Yes, she was.
Tell me something about George Kirby and the future now. What's happening?
Well, I'm in the midst right now of getting one of the shows that I've written, one of the plays I've written called King Heroin. And it involves all the drugs in this meeting room with the devil. The two non-drugs is the pimp and the thief.
Uh-huh.
And we're working on that now. Not only the play, uh-huh. but we're working on it for an album
uh-huh.
and also for a cassette. For video.
Right. That's great.
And there's been a big problem going right now. You know.
George, you just worked. You brought us a lovely, lovely little children today.
Uh-huh.
Tell me about this lovely... George, where did you just... You did a benefit somewhere?
I did a benefit for the People Who Care Youth Center. They were about to lose the building.
Uh-huh.
And they, what happened was, when I was in Terminal Island, Charles Battle, who's connected with the center, told me, he says, you know, when you get out, I'd appreciate it if you could help me with my kids.
Right.
I said, I'd be glad to. So time passed by, I get an early parole, I'm out in the street, and he approached me again, and I said, yeah. So I go over there, and I look at the center, see what's happening, see the wonderful things they're doing for the kids and everything. I said, all right, let me do something. I get in touch with Dick Sheenan, who is a master at getting stars together and putting on a big benefit, you know. And we got it together, put the benefit on at Washington High School, raised enough money to start negotiating to buy.
Right.
And we're going to do that every year. We're going to have a show every year with stars, and we're going to save that building. We're going to save those kids.
Why don't you bring them on for me, George, would you? Why don't you introduce these kids? They are called the Love Child.
The Love Child.
The Love Child.
The Lovable Love Child.
The Lovable Love Child.
Let's Here they are.
Thank you. Wow, Love Child, aren't they? George, how about that? Virginia, lovely.
Great.
The Lafayette Players, we got to sign him up there. How about that?
A lot of talent there, lots of
aren't
talent.
Aren't they adorable?
Yes, they are.
George,
more than adorable.
George Kirby.
What I like is they got them working. Hey. They got them busy. That's how children stay out of trouble. Keep them busy.
Is that it? Is that the secret?
Of course it's a secret. That's Didn't your mama keep you busy?
That's right.
I know your mother kept you busy.
I kept me very busy.
I kept busy on my own.
I kept busy, too.
Is that what you tell the young performers out there today, Virginia Capers?
First thing I tell them is to get an education. That's number one. Mm-hmm. Because in this business, just like George will tell you, you meet people from every walk of life.
Right.
And there's that security in having an education. Uh-huh. And then if you're going to be in this business, keep this together.
Yes, yes.
Keep this together. Keep your head together.
Of course.
And be of a single eye. Mm-hmm. Be of a single. If you're going to give it your best, give it your all.
Yes.
Give it your all. And don't compromise your talent. Don't compromise. Don't bastardize. Don't prostitute. Don't compromise. Go for it.
George Kirby.
Yes.
Ed Sullivan. Tell me about that. Oh, must have been great those days, get on Ed Sullivan days.
Oh, yeah, I did.
You've done a lot of them.
21 years with him.
21 years.
21 years.
I never got the opportunity. I was an Arthur Godfrey loser.
Yeah, where you going?
Well, you know, a lot of people don't realize, they forget. I was in television when it was Kinescope.
You really were?
Yes, in New York. I was on Kate Smith's show when she had a show.
Right.
When Jackie Gleason had the band, the big orchestra, and was conducting the big orchestra,
yes.
Numbers he wrote, you know.
Yes, of course.
I was on there with Gary Moore and Derwood Kirby when they had Martha Davis and Spouse. And used to bring the animals
Martha
on. This
yes.
is all black, white kinescope.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And with Milton Berle when they first started out right. with him and everything, you know, and the guy on the corner with the mm-hmm. derby.
Of course. Many years, George.
Yes.
You've been
yes.
a long time in this business, show
that
business.
Was that before the Second World War?
Yes.
Yes, of uh-huh. course, of course. George Kirby, tell me something.
Yes.
How come not George Kirby show?
Yeah.
I mean, Virginia Capers, can't you see? I mean, we're ready. It's been ready for a long time. Why not, George? Are you aiming for this, or what's happening with it? The George Kirby show.
Well, they're showing the old show that I did up in Canada now called Half the George Kirby Comedy Hour.
Right.
They're showing it now.
Yep.
And everybody comes up to me saying...
You should be a comedy host.
He should be a comedy host. He should have his own.
He should be a comedy host and invite comedians, you know, the ones that he has yes. the good raps
good
with.
Raps.
The ones that write their own material.
Right.
The ones that are slick. The ones that can pull
clean
it out of the air.
And clean
oh,
material.
Oh, God, please.
George Kirby has always been a gentleman comedian, entertainer. He's never been vulgar on stage.
Oh,
no.
I love it.
George, how
you
come these young
the
entertainers
children.
Use those words, F, on stage? How can they do it? How can they really do it?
Well,
just
permits it.
You see,
is that
they
what you
have,
think?
They have an audience.
They have an audience for it.
They have an audience
yeah.
for it.
Yeah.
Who permits it?
Yeah.
You know, then I have an audience.
You have your audience, George.
That's right. Yes. Bill Cosby has an audience
yes.
too because he's clean.
And he is number one. Line. It shows you. He's
the
number
show
one.
Is number one.
He is. And yeah. I think George Kirby, if had a show, would be number one too. What do you think, Virginia? I really
Listen,
think
I would tune it in, let me tell you. I would tune it in.
Say something before we leave, George. I meant
something,
like something
honey,
of your bosses. You know, I love Pearl Bailey again. I love to hear one of your Pearl Bailey's things.
Well, honey, I certainly appreciate being on the show today, darling, and all the wonderful compliments. I just love it, darling, really. Made me feel good. You made my day.